Okay, Sarah Thornton, thank you very much indeed. That's what we're discussing on your call. Just let me remind you of the question before we hand over to news. We're slightly late for news. Is it fair to bring race into this? Your thoughts, 0500 909 693. And here are the headlines.
Two organisations representing NHS...
Good morning. Serious questions are being asked about how a gang of men from Pakistan and North Africa originally were able to groom, rape and abuse young girls in Oxford. Is it fair to bring race into this? Similar cases have been prosecuted in Blackburn, Rochdale and other towns. Mohammed Shafiq from the Ramadan Foundation says the perpetrator's background is a factor.
Child sexual abuse affects all communities, but it's very important to recognise, as members of the Pakistani community, we've got a problem. There are some criminals who think that white girls are worthless. They think they can be used and abused.
Guardian journalist Joseph Harker says it's not fair to single out one community.
These are just tiny numbers of cases, tiny numbers of people. And just as with Stuart Hall, Jimmy Savile and all the other cases of child abuse which have involved white perpetrators, to make racial stereotypes or religious stereotypes is just wrong-headed.
Well, does focusing on race, religion, does it detract from the real issue or culture? Powerful men preying on the weak. What about the failures of the police, of social workers, of local authorities? Or is facing up to cultural differences, different attitudes that... go way back, perhaps, are vital to ending this pattern of abuse? Is it fair to bring race into this? What do you think? 0500 909 693. Anne Cryer joins us, who's been campaigning on this for many years. Former Labour MP in Keighley in West Yorkshire. Hello, Anne.
Hello, Nikki.
Hi. Asad Zaman is with us as well, an imam in Manchester. Good morning to you.
Morning, Nikki.
And Anne Cryer, is it fair to bring race into this?
No, I don't think it's race. I mean, it's absurd to say that everyone from a certain race is going to behave in a certain way. No, it's cultural practices that have been imported into this country from Pakistan. And one mustn't lose sight of that fact. And we can't just turn a blind eye to it.
So it's culture, is it?
I'm sorry?
Is it a sort of cultural
I think it's the...
You think?
There's a very paternalistic culture in Pakistan. I mean, how many women were involved in the general election the other day? Very few. Things did improve at one time, but that seems to have gone by the board. So I think we've got to look at it from a cultural practices that, unfortunately... we have a large, I'm not saying it's unfortunate, we have a large Pakistani community. I think it's unfortunate that that large Pakistani community in many areas, not quite so much in London, but certainly in the north, have imported from Pakistan the views that women are not worth much and therefore they don't care too much about what happens to them. I think another thing against the race card is that there are, I think there's nearly 100 cases going through the courts in West Yorkshire at the moment about this sort of crime. Two of the victims are Pakistani girls,
mm-hmm.
not from Pakistan, but of Pakistani heritage. So, I mean, we need to look at that. And if I can just go on a bit more, Nikki.
Two out of 100 or two out of many more?
Sorry,
there are 100 cases of 100 victims, did you
yes.
say?
Yes.
Two of which are of Pakistani
yes.
heritage.
That's
okay.
right, yes. Right. That's as far as I'm aware.
Mm.
We won't know really until they actually do come to court and we really understand the full extent.
Mm.
But can I just say that I have had conversations with friends, women, in the Pakistani community, and one of the things that they're horrified by is the way the community, the biradaris, the families, treat these men. As if, you know, it doesn't matter all that much. If it was girls, if it was Pakistani girls who were getting out of line, whether it was refusing to marry a certain man at a certain time or whatever, they would be put on a plane back to Pakistan, or worse, they may be killed. I think about 12 women are the victims of honour crimes in this country every year. Many of those honour crimes... are because of their behaviour.
Okay, let's bring Asad Zaman in to respond to some of those very powerful
yeah.
put points. Asad Zaman.
Hi, Nikki. you know, in some ways I agree with Anne. In other ways, I'm totally shocked by what she has to say. Which aspect
shocked you?
Well, she said that these are cultural practices from Pakistan. Now, you know, what exactly do you mean by that, Anne? Because, you know, is fornication or adultery something that is condoned? Is paedophilia condoned? Total abuse of young, vulnerable children, young girls like this, is that condoned or encouraged by the culture of Pakistan? I mean, it's shocking that you could possibly demonize an entire culture because of the behavior of a few evil individuals from that culture.
I'm saying that in Pakistan, there's a very, very strong paternalistic element that means that frequently men get away with such things as even murder without being punished, whereas girls are very much on the receiving end of punishments, whether it's by their family or by the criminal justice system.
I said to mine, all societies have their problems, clearly, but the prevalence of rape, for example, in Pakistan, official sanctioning, women feeling stigmatised by it, you know, the severity of the rape problem in Pakistan, police indifference to it is well documented.
Yeah, I mean, I don't think
I
don't think we need to justify it to this man.
You know what it is. First of all, are these people who've been convicted, are they influenced by Pakistani culture, or
yes,
are they influenced by the very promiscuous culture in which we are living in this secular liberal environment? I mean, we are living in an environment, and you know, survey after survey is telling us, over the past 30 years, they've been telling us that half of all 14-year-old girls in this country, irrespective of race or religion or whatever background, they're having regular sex. Half of all 14-year-old girls are having regular sex. Now, you know,
So whose fault is this? Who are the victims here? The men who have been lured by this promiscuous culture? Or, I mean, who are you saying are the victims here? I'm a bit unclear. Is it the fault of British culture for being so promiscuous? Is that what you're saying?
Without a doubt, let's be very, very categorical about this. These are individuals who have perpetrated very serious crimes, and just like, you know, Jimmy Savile or Gary Glitter or Stuart Hall, they are sexual predators that need to be dealt with very, very seriously.
There's something wrong with British sexual promiscuity in the culture that has brought us to this position. Are you saying that?
What I'm saying is that there are elements within our culture. For example, the predominance of pornography. If you look at what influences have are on our children generally, that are bringing them up in a way that they don't value women the way they ought to value them, the way they ought to respect them, that pornographic culture, and you know, it's just two clicks away on the internet, that is seriously undermining the very fabric of the respect that boys should have for girls.
So if these men had been living, so if these men had been living in Pakistan, they would not have been behaving like this.
Oh, no, I'm not saying that at all, because you've got evil individuals in every culture, in every country of the world, and who knows, you know, what influences would have been on these people.
There was a study of child sex abuse in Islamabad.
Clearly are people, you know, who are sort of have an evil inclination, and therefore, God knows, you know, how they would have been brought up. But without a shadow of doubt, you know, let's look at, for example, the actual statistics, you know, in terms of convictions. Yes, you know, we've got a lot of cases of suspects, but let's look at the actual conviction rate within this country. There's 8,000 men behind bars in England and Wales for child sex offences. 82% are white, 10% are black, and 4% are Asian. From amongst those 4% Asian, they're going to be of Pakistani origin, Indian origin, Bangladeshi origin, Sri Lankan. They may well be Muslim, Christian, Hindus, Buddhist, Sikhs. Let's just assume that, you know, 3% are Muslim out of these 4% Asian. This is 3%.
Okay.
97% are not Muslim. So why are you, you know, making race such a major issue in this thing?
I think, Anne Cryer, you're not making race an issue. You're making culture an issue. Culture an issue, aren't you, Anne Cryer? But respond to those points, then we'll go to the calls.
Can I just mention that the vast majority of those men who are behind bars for grooming of young girls and abusing them, they acquire their victims online. The difference between the online grooming of white men and the street gang grooming of young girls by Pakistani men is quite marked. And the cases that are coming up week after week at the moment of Pakistani men being charged with these offences, it causes me a lot of concern, because what I want to happen is I want their own community not to have a lynch mob, but to certainly express their anger and their frustration and their unhappiness with the behaviour of these men. And I'm not sure that this is happening on the ground in the towns and cities of the north. And I think even councillors, people in the civil community, should be getting involved in this. They should be saying this is not good enough. As I say, I have talked to Asian women, Pakistani women, and they have pointed out to me time and again that the problem is that if this sort of behaviour was being carried out by Pakistani girls, they would have been had their throat slit, or they would have been sent back to Pakistan, or they would have been locked away in a room. Now, I cannot believe that the Biradaris, the communities, do not know of what's going on. The front page of The Guardian says this morning that two of those brothers who are being convicted, will be sentenced next week, were actually regular attenders at the mosque.
Okay.
Now, I mean, are we to believe that no one in that community, in the Biradaris, knew what was going on, and therefore that's why
you can point to the world of the 60s BBC, you can point to the Catholic Church, you can point to all sorts of other institutions, just to throw that one in. Thank you, Anne. Thank you very much indeed to Asad Zaman. We're going to go with calls next. It's 9:19. Here's the travel.
Your call.
Let's hear from Sarah in Warwickshire. Good morning, Sarah.
Morning, Nikki.
Hello. What would you like to say?
I don't think it is a race issue, and I don't think it's fair to actually say that it is. For me personally, I think it is about these evil, disgusting men taking advantage of these young, vulnerable children and women. I work with young women. I work with youth from age 14 to 24, and it's about empowering them, making sure that they're aware of the dangers, and giving them the knowledge to know what is grooming, as well as vindicating these people that do these things. But as I was saying, it's not a race thing. This happens in all different areas of life. It's not just Pakistani people that do this, or black people, or Indian people. And Muslims, it absolutely drives me nuts when Muslims are bought into it. I'm a Muslim woman. I've got Muslim brothers that respect their women, respect their wives. I live in a community where there is respect for women, but I also see people that don't respect their women. They can be from the Pakistani community, or they can be from the English community.
Well, the problem is, isn't it, the Pakistani community is such a portmanteau, such a huge term, isn't it? Because, you know, it's difficult to, you know, we should always talk about communities, because, you know, there are so many subsections, aren't there?
No, I agree with that. I agree that that the community is split into different subsections, but to tar everyone with the same brush, I mean, that's like saying with the whole Jimmy Savile thing that all celebrities should be looked at in this way, and I'm sure you wouldn't appreciate that.
Or all Catholic priests or whatever.
Exactly, and it's not right. I mean,
do you agree with thoughtful people like Mohammed Shafiq, though, who come on from the Ramadan Foundation, and, you know, he says, look, there is a certain problem and we can't hide away from it within our communities. We need to look at it. We need to sort it. Do you agree with that?
I don't agree with that it's just linked to the Pakistani community. I think that as a society, we need to respect each other, and that involves men respecting women, women respecting men. I think that's a society thing. I don't think that's just down to one community. So in some ways, yes, I do agree with him, and in others, I don't. I think, like the other gentleman called that you had, I don't know his name, Assad, I think it was, he was saying about pornographic material, etc., and sexualisation. I don't quite agree to the extent.
Well, no, because if you look at the situation for women and girls in Pakistan, it's pretty grim.
Yeah, but that's their culture there. It shouldn't be here in Britain, and that's not the Pakistani men bringing it over here. As we heard on the news report, they were British-born Pakistani men. So you wouldn't say a British-born English person or a British-born Chinese person. It just detracts away from the actual situation. It should be that these men, whoever, whatever culture they were from, took advantage of these young people. It should be actually penalising the crime and the perpetrators, regardless of their race.
Mm. Really interesting call. Stay there, listen to Ali and Slough. Ali, do you agree with that?
Ali, yes, I generally agree with that, Nikki, and I just want to add another point. There are two points. Firstly, the media, whether it's broadcast or print, has either negligently, recklessly, or dishonestly brought Pakistani race or the Islamic faith into it. These people are about as religious as Trotsky was, or Lenin, for that matter. And secondly, they grew up here, they spent their life here, and I'll read like you a couple of headlines. White male BBC journalist abuses vulnerable white girls for four decades. The entire BBC supported him. Savile, Stuart Hall, and the list is endless. Now as for Anne Cryer making her undignified distinction between somebody who prowls the internet to abuse a child and some scumbag who lures them with alcohol and drugs, it's an undignified distinction to try and make, and one which is anything but sincere, to be very honest.
Well, let's put that to Anne Cryer has to respond to that.
I'm sorry I've been so undignified, but I think we are dealing with some very important questions. And as always, I am more or less on the side of women. I argue for 13 years against the forced marriages and other honour crimes perpetrated against Asian women. At the moment, I'm arguing that the Pakistani community, because most of these gangs are emanating from that community, I'm arguing that the Pakistani community, either religious or secular, should be doing more to influence young men. I'm also arguing that I think the community knows a little bit more about what's going on than they're admitting to.
Nikki, can I come in there?
Yes, Sarah, go on, Sarah.
I just want to say to Anne that as an Asian British Muslim, I don't agree with what she's just said. I've been to the Islamic schools with men in the actual classes, and they are taught to respect their women. Islam teaches you to respect your women.
I know that.
Jewels.
I know that.
So you can't say that, you know, they're not being taught how to do this. Just as children in schools are taught, you know, to respect one another, there will be still a minority that go on to do these horrible crimes. The other thing that you said is people that know about these, know these things in the community. People didn't know about Jimmy Savile. People didn't know about, you know, all the other crimes that have been committed in the Catholic Church. They didn't know. They didn't say about it. So how can you say that the community knows?
Can I just add something, Anne, before you respond? And Ali, we'll let Anne respond. Can I just add something? And you may find this interesting, Sarah. I'm reading from the excellent Islamic Society of Britain website. I'm reading a very interesting and thoughtful piece by Julie Siddiqui there, who says, I'm willing to go as far as to say there does seem to be a pattern emerging of people from the same background, and we need to be open about that and do something about it. It's certainly not Islam, anything but associations with names and imagery will inevitably be made when the police make arrests. And let's face it, those associations with Islam will be exploited too. She makes that point, but she makes the point that something needs to be done about it and a pattern is emerging. But would you agree with that, Sarah?
I agree that Islam, with the article that you've just read, that Islam doesn't teach us to do this sort of thing. But at the same time, you know, these crimes that are being committed, they're committed in all walks of life. I know Anne made the comparison to grooming on the internet, and that is still grooming, regardless of whether it's done from a taxi cab or whether it's done on the internet. It's still grooming, and it is in all walks of life. It's not just the Pakistani community. And as I was saying before, it's a society problem. Society needs to treat each other with respect. Men need to treat women as women, as people, not as objects, and that's in all walks of life, not just the
Nikki, can I come back, please?
Very quickly, Ali. Yeah, I've got to do an interview.
If Anne made a mistake, then she should say so, but other than that, clearly there's a contrived suggestion here that somehow some form of abuse is worse than others. All forms of abuse of children, of anyone, is abuse. And as for what she's suggesting, perhaps you can rewrite Macaulay's Minute of Indian Education to the modern age. I mean, let's get real. There's a due process in this country. It took its course. These people were convicted. They're going to go to prison for a long time. And as many there as there are, bring them all out. People in the BBC knew Savile was up to no good. Stuart Hall. What are you going to do? String them all up outside and say, people like Nicky Campbell, you knew it all along, mate. Come on. You're as guilty as Savile was. No, you're not. So, Anne Craig, wake up rather than peddling your half-truths and myths for your own agenda.
Last word, Anne.
Well, I haven't peddled a single half-truth or myth this morning. I'm on this programme not because I came in from the moon, but because I was dealing with such cases in 02. That's 11 years ago. And at that time, I persuaded a friend of mine, who was a Labour councillor on Bradford Council, to take to the elders of the mosque, I think it was 36 names and addresses of young men who I knew from mothers of girls who were being abused, were abusing these girls. He very kindly took it to the elders, and the elders said, it's nothing to do with us. Now, I mean, it may be that that was just one-off, and it may be that since 02, this sort of thing hasn't happened, and it may just be that none of our mosques, none of our community centres know what's going on at all.
Okay.
But certainly in 02, I presented these men, and they were all men, with the names and addresses of young men who were abusing girls in order to ask them to modify their behaviour towards these young women, and they didn't want to know. Now, this may be still the case. I'm sorry if it is. I just wish that I could wave a magic wand and change it all. I don't have an agenda at all.
Anne, thank you very much indeed.
You.
And thank you to all our excellent callers thus far. I was just quoting from Julie Sadiqa's article. Strange things happen in radio. She just walked into the studio to talk to us, and she's going to do just that after 9:30. Good morning to you.
Morning.
Morning. Let's get, first of all, before we proceed, some figures for you, and we're talking about unemployment figures. Andy. We're discussing the appalling cases in Oxford. Is it fair to bring heritage and culture into this? Let's speak to, we're going to speak to Peter Saunders, actually. Always good to have Peter on, National Association for People Abused in Childhood. Morning, Peter.
Good morning, Nick.
And Julie Siddiqui is here from the Islamic Society of Britain, the founder of the new Community Alliance Against Sexual Exploitation Group, which has been set up to tackle grooming. Now, as we were just saying off the air to each other, Julie Siddiqui, the details of this case are too appalling to have printed in some newspapers. Mm. We are talking about a hellish situation here. What's your message this morning?
I think my main message to people is, look, we don't want to make this a sort of Asian versus white issue or a Muslim versus other issue, because I think that narrows it too much and doesn't do justice to the victims. But I think, you know, all good people in this country reading about these cases today are outraged and just appalled and sickened, and rightly so. And I think it just really creates an environment where all of us need to come together and speak out and do what we can, really.
Mm. Is there a problem in specific communities, as some are saying, or is that just a kind of a form of racism in itself to say that?
Well, I think we need to be careful. I certainly welcome the reporting. I think this time has been a lot more sort of nuanced, and people are discussing it a bit like we are now, whereas in some of the other cases, perhaps it was a bit more sensationalised and people were trying to get to grips with what was really happening. I've certainly, on record, and will say again now, that I think if there are patterns emerging, if there are men from certain backgrounds that are committing these horrific crimes, then we can't afford, any of us can't afford to keep quiet about that and kind of go into almost some sort of victim mindset and say, look, you know, it's not one community, all communities have abusers. Of course we know that all communities have abusers in there, but if we're seeing patterns emerging and there's problems, then we need to get to the bottom of that. What's gone wrong? Why do these men behave?
Have you got
this
anywhere
way?
Towards that in debate, or is it still such a sensitive area that people are not engaging?
No, I think it's still relatively new. I think some people are having it. What we don't want are the kind of polarised views where one will say, you know, it's all Asian men, Islam is somehow the problem, you know, all Muslims Muslim men think about this, about women in this way. Of course, that's nonsense. That's not the case.
And it doesn't help.
And it doesn't help. But then on the other side, people, you know, kind of in denial or not speaking out and feeling that they don't have a role in that. I think that's very dangerous either. I quite like this middle ground that we seem to be in, where we feel able to talk and debate. I welcome all of the viewpoints, but as long as we can all, you know, discuss it in a kind of...
We had an imam on earlier saying, oh, Asian children being brought up with white values of promiscuity and loose sexual morals. Not helpful either.
Yeah, I mean, again, that's, you know, kind of almost putting the blame onto victims somehow, which I just feel, you know, horrendous. I mean, I've got a 15-year-old daughter. I look at her and girls her age or younger and feel how on earth have they been manipulated and damaged in such a way that they actually start to believe that this kind of behaviour is normal. You know, these girls are our daughters and sisters, whatever their background. I just feel that whatever we can do, we have to do. I feel that also, you know, to say that all of the victims are white girls, certainly the ones that have come forward in these last few cases have been. I absolutely have no doubt that there are victims of Asian and other backgrounds as well, girls who may be, for whatever reason, certainly culturally or within the communities, find it even harder to come forward. And some of the work that we need to do on the ground is to try and help them to feel safe, to be able to come forward. And, you know, let's really get to the bottom of this.
Are there any cultural attitudes towards women that need to be addressed?
I think cultural attitudes are there, yes. Certainly not part of the faith, but certainly culturally there will be attitudes that men hold towards women. It's not to say that all Asian / Pakistani men, or certainly all Muslim men,
or all men of Pakistani heritage. No, Muslim community leader said to me over a cup of coffee once, you know what the problem, I'm just quoting him, so don't anyone throw the brickbat. He said, do you know what the problem here is? He said, it's people with links from rural villages in Pakistan.
Yeah, and obviously, you
is
know...
Anything, he said like that to me, and I was thinking, oh, a bit of, you know, social snobbery there, but is there anything... I don't know if there's anything or not. Is there anything in that?
No, I think all of these discussions need to be had, you know, and if I go on...
Well, have it.
On air, we are having it. Yeah, and we are having it, and I think that's it. You know, we need to, you know, bring it on, really. Bring it on. Let's have the debate. Rather than hide away and pretend it's not happening, let's do it in the way that we are now.
Yeah. Okay. Peter Saunders, what do you think? I mean, lots of people are saying, hey, 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 Savile, hey, 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 you know, Stuart Hall, hey, 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 you know, Vatican.
Quite.
Is that what you're saying?
Hi, Julie. Julie and I were on the settee on breakfast telly this morning. Yep. Seem to be following each other around. It's good to...
Delighted to replicate.
Yeah, absolutely.
I wonder why you were wearing makeup, Peter.
Nikki, there's a gang of white men in West London. It's pretty well documented now. That used to visit a guest house. I'm going to leave names out of this completely. Certainly the gang included former government ministers, and I expect a former cabinet minister to be arrested sometime soon. And I think that will, again, bring the focus back into reality, which is that...
This is an ongoing case. You expect arrests in it soon, yeah? Yeah,
I do. And
and people will not then be saying, is there a problem in... such and such a community.
I think it will be such a big story, Nikki, that it will make us temporarily forget the issues in Oxford, Rochdale and others.
When's it going to happen?
I don't know. And I would never preempt or therefore talk about it in any more detail because we wouldn't want to jeopardise or compromise a legal case.
But I will be calling you later.
Julie is absolutely right. There are patterns of behaviour in certain communities which are unhelpful, challenging and downright... you know, mischievous, to say the least, and we've seen that in certain places around the country. But the wider issue of child abuse is that every culture, every community, every race seems to produce people who have a capacity, and at NAIPAC we hear from the victims, as you know, Nikki, every single day, who have the capacity to inflict great, great terror on our children, and it's got to stop. And I think it's time, and we're now saying to the government, if they're listening, which I'm not sure, we've got to have a royal commission. We've got to have mandate now for mandatory reporting of child abuse in institutions. Savile and many other people in institutions. I was on Radio Leeds this morning talking about the very latest figures of Savile's offending within hospitals and victims as young as 5, and nobody did anything about it. It's got to be compulsory. People have got to sign up to mandate now to compel the government to introduce mandatory reporting for when somebody witnesses, not a rumour, but when somebody witnesses abuse. And we know that happened in the Savile case, and there's many others that I could spend the morning talking to you about. We've got to get a grip, Nikki.
Let's get Saika in Birmingham on the programme. And thank you so much for getting in touch with us. Good morning.
Good morning, Nikki, and morning to your guest as well. I just wanted to say, well, firstly, I agree with various callers in various respects, but particularly I do agree with Julie, and to a large degree, Anne Cryer, and I think, you know, she's taken a lot of flack this morning.
Can I ask, are you a Muslim woman?
Yes, I am.
Right, okay. And you agree with Anne Cryer? What do you agree with? What was it that Anne Cryer said that you agree with?
I feel Anne's anger, and I feel her passion for this because, like she said, she's been campaigning for absolutely years. It's only now got to the level that it has in terms of media profile, this particular issue. But what I really wanted to say was that in terms of it being a race religious issue, I think it's unhelpful to keep banging on about that because it detracts from the very real issue that's affecting the lives of young girls. And I don't want to sideline this into it becoming a race religious type of issue when in actual fact it's an issue about dehumanizing girls, and at the core of this that's what it is. And what I'm really concerned, it's really good to hear Julie saying that we need to, you know, work together on this and come to some sort of middle ground, and there are really hopeful signs that within the Muslim community and Muslim organizations they are taking this on now. But sadly, there's a pocket of society and pocket of the Muslim community that is not taking this seriously. And when one of your earlier Muslim callers, I think it was Sarah, said that there's a lot of respect for women taught from the pulpits and the mosques, that's absolutely true. And of course, as a Muslim, I know that Islam accords me rights and I know what I'm entitled to. But sadly, the pulpits on a Friday, they don't talk about the respect that should be accorded to young white girls or young girls, full stop. And I think one of your callers talked about promiscuity in society. That was unhelpful to put it in the way that he did. But what is a real issue is self-esteem amongst young girls, regardless of whether they're white or Asian or black, self-esteem, self-worth, and what it is to be a woman in this society. And I think, you know, there are groups that are doing that. And I want to join those people that work on that level so that these girls are not vulnerable. And I think that's a real issue that needs to be addressed. And I don't think the Muslim community is in a position to address it at the moment because they've got other things that they need to address. But they need to address it, and I think, as a society. And I think what Peter was saying, and I don't know much about his organisation, but hopefully that's sort of what they're doing, and that's okay. What they need to do.
You make some very, very interesting points. I know, Julie Steek, I think you've got to dash off second, but you know, respond before you go.
Yeah, no, I mean, here, really, and well done for Psyche for sort of putting it in such an eloquent way. I think I would just like to say that we're certainly working with the likes of Victim Support, and at our launch on Friday to kcaase.org.uk, we actually had the CEO of Victim Support. So actually, for me, you know, I've cried about these girls. You know, they
and
are.
And when she said there that she doesn't think some Muslims are being taught in the mosques to respect young white girls in the same way that they're being taught to respect other women, did she have a point?
No, I think she does have a point. You know, I think we have to put our hands up and say that, you know, there's a lot more that needs to be done. And, you know, the Friday sermon idea, which I've seen floated around online today, the idea of doing a sort of one day of Friday sermons on this issue, possibly at the end of June, I think is a fantastic idea. And, you know, I really welcome that. So I think the more we can do about this, the better, really.
Thank you very much. Good to see you.
Thanks.
I saw you on the telly earlier. Good to have you in the studio here. Julie Siddiqui from the Islamic Society of Britain. And Peter, Julie's got a dash off. You're welcome to stay if you want for a few more minutes. I don't know what your commitments are. I would imagine they're quite busy today, Peter.
Happy to stay for a few more minutes.
Great. We'll
Nikki.
Take more calls as well. Here's Michelle with the travel news. Good morning. And let me see. We have got Juliet in Woodford Green. Hello. And we're going to speak to Robert in East London. Robert, on you go.
Nikki, I just happen to be working in East London. I actually live in Bicknor, in Oxfordshire. And I had a conflict with a professional family, a well-to-do family, over a period of 6 years. If I had a barbecue in my garden, they would call the police. It would be a racial attack on them. Now, I learned over that period of 6 years that the police and our local district council would just back off as soon as the word racial was mentioned, nobody wanted to know.
That's interesting. So you think there is a kind of sensitivity. I mean, Peter Saunders, Anne Cryer mentioned this, that she encountered this, you know, she encounters it less so now in terms of cases like the street grooming, but she said initially she did encounter this. Do you think there might be any validity in that, Peter Saunders?
Well, I agree with what Julie Siddiqui was saying earlier, was that yes, there is some substance to aspects of certain cultures and certain gangs of men that come together to hurt kids. But given that we're almost you're almost out of off air, Nikki, is it possible to just mention NAPAC? Because the lady who was on earlier was saying she didn't know much about us, and I think it's important that people know, because one of the huge problems we've got, and we've discussed this many times.
If I said no, I'd be lynched.
You know me well. One of the huge problems we've got is we're uncovering these vile crimes, but there is so few resources out there to support the victims.
Well, before you mention it then, you mentioned this crime earlier on, and we're all thinking, my goodness me, you believe there's another major case to be imminent, which will take the headlines.
I do.
Have there been adequate resources, do you believe, from the police to investigate? But we're seeing a lot of arrests at the moment. We're seeing a lot of very high-profile people. Sounds to us like, reading between the lines, a lot of resources are being put into this.
Well, at long last, the police are getting more resources, and I believe if and when a former British cabinet member is arrested, which I believe may well happen, I can't say it will because I'm not the police, but if it happens, I think it will bring into sharp focus the fact that children are in danger from just about, you know, every sector of society.
If I may, this is in relation to a ring.
Indeed.
Somebody's mentioned when they're white.
I've spoken to some of the victims.
When they're white, it's a ring. When they're Asian, it's a gang. Oh, it's exactly. A gang's a ring. A ring's a gang.
Yeah,
right.
And language is important. We do use language. You know, the driver was taking me somewhere the other day was saying, you know, when there's a when there's an incident with a black driver, it's always a black B person. But when it's a white driver, no one ever says it's a white B. You know, the expletive I'm leaving out. And I think there is a lot in that. I mean, we've got to nail this racial thing. We're a multicultural society. But again, coming back to NAPAC and to the many smaller organizations around the country that are trying to work with survivors of abuse, they need resources and they're not getting them.
They're not getting them.
None. No.
I did introduce Juliet. Sorry, Juliet.
That's okay, Nikki. Your program's always very interesting. Nikki, I've worked with young people, vulnerable young people. I do not play the race card. I think it's society, the social services, the police, and importantly, parents. Parents need to take control of their children. There are too many young people out there, and I live in Woodford, which is affluent, it's very greeny. But you see them out in the streets all hours of the night with bottles of vodka that they've gone got somebody else to buy for them in Sainsbury's or wherever. Nikki, society, we need to take responsibility of our young people. Our young people are our future. It's no point in saying the race. The race is not it. It's young people who are not being helped or supported in our society. And I think this is where the problem starts.
At the self-esteem issue.
You know, and the schools, you know, and also when the children go with their jewellery or whatever, instead of the parents saying, where did you get that from, and chastising them, they're encouraging them to go out and get more because there's no control. My son's 30. I need to know where he is.
Do you?
It's a responsibility. And it doesn't stop. And as parents, we must not take away the responsibility. And the society, social services, needs to really now go, stop all the talk. Every case that comes up, oh, well, we could have done it different. We're now going to have an investigation. No, you don't need the investigation. You have failed those young people. They went and reported it to social services and to the police, and no help was given them.
Absolutely.
Peter, do you want to come back in?
Yeah, no, that lady, you're absolutely right. I think it's actually time that we had a royal commission into just how we the the culture of the way in which we bring children up, treat children. I mean, materially now, children are relatively well looked after. We know that. But psychologically, emotionally, so many of our children are just abandoned at an early age. And as that lady said, left to their own devices. I'm not talking about turning the clock back. I'm about talking about moving forward. But
Moving forward, yes.
Absolutely.
And helping them.
Absolutely. And that is our responsibility as society.
And I'm looking for organisations that I can get myself involved.
And our children will be the ones that will be putting us in those care homes in a few years' time. So I don't want to go there.
I don't want to go there either.
Exactly. Peter's in Durham and Martin's in Durham. Durham. Hello.
Good morning. Good
Martin,
morning.
Quick points, please. Quick point, Martin.
If this had been this has nothing to do with the race card, and Anne Cryer should have a damehood for what her work she's done. I've seen her on your programme on Sunday. If this had been the other way around, if this had been eight white men perpetrating crimes on young Asian and African, what are children, in fact, then there would have been MPs shouting from
That's exactly what has happened with the Savile. That's what has happened.
No, we're not talking about Savile.
It almost brought down the BBC.
Excuse me, can we get away from Western promiscuity, Savile Hall? Can we drag this back to the title of your call? Is it fair to bring race in? Yes, because the very people who brought race into this were the perpetrators of these disgusting crimes, which were these eight men who preyed on young, what appears to be 100% or predominantly white young children.
Let's get Peter to respond in Durham also.
Well,
yes.
Sorry, Peter, in Durham.
Yes. I don't think that you are going to prevent these sorts of things getting started. But I think detection and addressing these things is very important. What I see happening in all sorts of areas in policing is that single issues are put to the police. And if the police want to bring a case to court, they have to send it to CPS. What they do is they send a single file to CPS, and nobody ever manages to coordinate a series of incidents into a series of behaviours which should be addressed in a very serious way.
Well, this
manner.
Is exactly what Sarah Thornton was saying. She's the Chief Constable of Thames Valley Police. She came on and she said, you know, the dots were clearly not joined up, and she said they made a mistake in
absolutely,
not doing
Your
that.
Honour.
That's a very academic way of putting it, and that's...
I'm not sure, to be fair, she quite put it like that. I think I'm paraphrasing her. But if anyone's interested, if you missed it, it's on Twitter now, that interview, at BBC Five Live on the Five Live website. We're almost...
Can I just say there's been a lot of academia on here this morning? Can we drag it back to the title? Is it fair to bring race in?
Well, race is perhaps the wrong word.
I have friends from other countries.
Do you?
Yes. Yes. Southern Ireland and Iran. But was it? Yes, it was. And I hope to go down for 100 years.
Thank you very much indeed. Peter Saunders, the fight goes on. 20 seconds.
Indeed, and survivors can call the NAPAC free phone number, which I hope is still on the 5 Live website, Nikki, and thanks very much for the voice again.
Thank you all very much. We got there. Have a good day. See you tomorrow.
Things did improve at one time, but that seems to have gone by the board. So I think we've got to look at it from a cultural practices that, unfortunately, we have a large... I'm not saying it's unfortunate we have a large Pakistani community. I think it's unfortunate that large Pakistani community in many areas, not quite so much in London, but certainly in the north, have imported from Pakistan the views that women not worth much, and therefore they don't care too much about what happens to them. I think another thing against the race card is that there's nearly 100 cases going through the courts in West Yorkshire at the moment about this sort of crime. Two of the victims are Pakistani girls,
mm-hmm.
not from Pakistan, but of Pakistani heritage. So, I mean, we need to look at that. And if I can just go on a bit more, Nikki.
Two out of 100, or two out of many more?
Sorry?
So there are 100 cases of 100 victims, did you
yes.
say?
Yes.
Two of which are of Pakistani
yes.
heritage.
That's
okay.
right, yes. Right. That's as far as I'm aware.
Mm.
We won't know, really, until they actually do come to court and we really understand the full extent.
OK. Okay, Sarah Thornton, thank you very much indeed. That's what we're discussing on your call. Just let me remind you of the question before we hand over to news. We're slightly late for news. Is it fair to bring race into this? Your thoughts, 0500 909 693. And here are the headlines.
Two organisations representing NHS...
Good morning. Serious questions are being asked about how a gang of men from Pakistan and North Africa originally were able to groom, rape and abuse young girls in Oxford. Is it fair to bring race into this? Similar cases have been prosecuted in Blackburn, Rochdale and other towns. Mohammed Shafiq from the Ramadan Foundation says the perpetrator's background is a factor.
Child sexual abuse affects all communities, but it's very important to recognise, as members of the Pakistani community, we've got a problem. There are some criminals who think that white girls are worthless. They think they can be used and abused.
Guardian journalist Joseph Harker says it's not fair to single out one community.
These are just tiny numbers of cases, tiny numbers of people. And just as with Stuart Hall, Jimmy Savile and all the other cases of child abuse which have involved white perpetrators, to make racial stereotypes or religious stereotypes is just wrong-headed.
Well, does focusing on race, religion, does it detract from the real?
But can I just say that I have had conversations with friends, women, in the Pakistani community, and one of the things that they're horrified by is the way the community, the biradaris, the families, treat these men. As if, you know, it doesn't matter all that much. If it was girls, if it was Pakistani girls who were getting out of line, whether it was refusing to marry a certain man at a certain time or whatever, they would be put on a plane back to Pakistan, or worse, they may be killed. I think about 12... women are the victims of honour crimes in this country every year. Many of those honour crimes are because of their behaviour.
OK, let's bring Asad Zaman in to respond to some of those very powerful points. Asad Zaman.
Hi, Nikki. you know, in some ways I agree with Anne. In other ways I'm totally shocked by what she has to say.
Which aspect shocked you?
Well, she said that these are cultural practices from Pakistan. Now, you know, what exactly do you mean by that, Anne? Because, you know, is fornication or adultery something that is condoned? Is paedophilia condoned? Total abuse of young, vulnerable children, young girls like this, is that condoned or encouraged by the culture of Pakistan? I mean, it's shocking that you could possibly demonize an entire culture because of the behavior of a few evil individuals from that culture.
I'm saying that in Pakistan, there's a very, very strong paternalistic element that means that frequently men get away with such things as even murder without being punished, whereas girls are very much on the receiving end of punishments, whether it's by their family or by the criminal justice system.
Asad Zaman, all societies have their problems, clearly, but the prevalence of rape, for example, in Pakistan, official sanctioning, women feeling stigmatised by it, you know, the severity of the rape problem in Pakistan, police indifference to it is well documented.
Yeah, I mean, I don't think
I
don't think we need to justify it to this man.
You know what it is. First of all, are these people who've been convicted, are they influenced by Pakistani culture, or are they influenced by the very
issue or culture? Powerful men preying on the weak. What about the failures of the police, of social workers, of local authorities? Or is facing up to cultural differences, different attitudes that go way back, perhaps, are vital to ending this pattern of abuse? Is it fair to bring race into this? What do you think? 0500 909 693. Anne Cryer joins us, who's been campaigning on this for many years. Former Labour MP in Keighley in West Yorkshire. Hello, Anne.
Hello, Nikki.
Hi. Asad Zaman is with us as well, an imam in Manchester. Good morning to you.
Morning, Nikki.
And Anne Cryer, is it fair to bring race into this?
No, I don't think it's race. I mean, it's absurd to say that everyone from a certain race is going to behave in a certain way. It's cultural practices that have been imported into this country from Pakistan. And one mustn't lose sight of that fact. And we can't just turn a blind eye to it.
So it's culture, is it?
I'm sorry?
Is it a sort of cultural
I think it's...
you think?
There's a very paternalistic culture in Pakistan. I mean, how many women were involved in the general election the other day? Very few.